Hello, I'm Mr. R. Lidger, a retired lecturer in metallurgy preaching Christianity and Sikhism. Being a scientist, I have studied the thing logically, and my late father used to be a scientist too, BSc. And he also had a very analytical mind, so he will analyze things before he will speak. And that trait I'm carrying forward and study New Testament and render exposition of Gnostic Gospel and all those. So I produce over 2,500 videos on YouTube. So I go to Oxford University to attend lectures delivered by the renowned scientist. Oh, they have so many, you know, of rewards and other thing. Here is the one that I attended on 26 April 2012. So this was the advertisement placed by them. Thursday, 26 April 2012, 5 p.m. to 6:30. Trinity College, Danson Room, Seminar of the Ian Ramsey Center for Science and Religion in collaboration with the Order Project, London School of Economics. Why is science such a pain? The Book of Job and an overlooked ancient narrative for science studies, presented by Professor Tom McLeish, Pro-Vice-Chancellor, Research University of Durham. The seminar is free and open to public. So I went to attend it and I enjoyed it. But when I asked them some question, they could not give the answer. So I will give you the reason why. Scientists study the senses of nature, that is materials, but God is spirit with no material characteristics. In short, God our Father in spirit, Allah, ParBrahm, etc., does not obey the natural laws, but he works by grace and helps those who take refuge in him. Whereas the Demiurge, God Yahweh, called Brahma in India and Khuda in Arabic, obeys the natural laws, and such laws could be studied scientifically. So the Yahweh is the God of nature, male and female, and all that you see with your two naked eyes belongs to Yahweh. As we can see nature with our two naked eyes, that is, for example, male and female, Jew and Gentiles, all that, you know, black and brown. The men working for Yahweh, the priests in synagogues, etc., impose those natural laws on natural bodies, which is our physical body. And they themselves are bound, the priests themselves, you know, they are bound by those moral laws as well. So John the Baptist, an angel of Yahweh, was an ideal moral teacher, and he, unlike the hypocrite temple priest, was neither a hireling nor under the domination of any, as the temple priests were under the chief temple priest. For example, under the Pope, you know, you have so many of these dog-colored people, and they are all under the domination of the Pope. They are not free. In short, John the Baptist was a free man, but he did not enjoy the free will, otherwise he would have been a hypocrite, that he could not do whatever he likes. He was to obey by the laws which he had made, and then he can give exception, you know. That is, whatever he taught, that he practiced himself too. Now Christ Jesus came to work for God, that is Spirit, and in grace of our Father. He performed miracles that science of nature cannot explain. Thus the chosen 12 laborers in Jesus were trained in the vineyard of our Father, where the true vine, Christ Jesus, is planted by our Father, gardener. And the gate that leads to this vineyard is very narrow, that only the solitary virgins of Holy Spirit can enter. Now this gate, you know, with the Holy Spirit, when they enter, they love to stay there. Those who go with the evil spirit, they find it dry, you know, no use, you know, they can't make money over there. So they come out, you know. As our anointed elder brother, Christ Jesus himself, had free will. So Christ Jesus, in Jesus, you know, we have the free will and was a free man, both, you know, unlike the angels, and so did the laborer, had free will and were free men. So like our elder brother, we were in the same boat. This Christ Jesus stressed to them at the miracle of feeding the 5,000 in the wilderness with heavenly bread, gospel that originates from our Father, God, untouched by the human hands, in which the powers of God were displayed much tastier than the manna produced on earth, that is the letters of the law fed by Moses. So Jesus compared the manna and the bread he has prepared, tit for tat in Moses, our nature that leads to destruction of life, whilst presenting the other cheek is to hit the conscience of the person, not the physical body, that saves life too. Thus in God, life is saved if you take refuge in our Father, whilst life is destroyed in the sons of Satan, the hypocrite, the hypocrites, princes, kings, and emperors of darkness. You know, Jesus are talking about princes of darkness in the Middle East. In India, we had the kings and emperors of darkness who exploit letters to justify their killing, and they dominate the present dark age. Our letter killeth, spirit giveth life. After feeding the 5,000, the Jews of letter, who study, you know, Torah in Jerusalem and all those reading their books, you know, were very happy to enjoy the most tasty bread. And then Christ Jesus opened his mouth to preach gospel. Unless you eat the flesh of Jesus, that is, have ears to hear his word, which comes, which, you know, ear is our mouth. This is mouth for in Yahweh, this is mouth in God. So unless you have ears to hear, whatsoever comes out of the mouth of Jesus, and drink the blood of Christ that is represented by preaching gospel from your living hearts and not from the scripts. That's why Jesus said, don't take any scripts with you. Gospel comes from the heart, not these people having Bible under their armpits going around. They are donkeys carrying holy books. And not the dead books. You have no part in me. The true vine which our father gardener planted. Jews, the men of letters, drunk with the old wine of Moses, could not take the saying in spirit, and they disappeared. They say, hey, this man feeds us with such a tasty bread, and now he say, kill me and eat my flesh, literal meaning. So they run away, you know, that hey, we can't do it. At this juncture, at this instance, Christ Jesus asked his laborers that you too have the free will to leave me. But Peter stressed that you are giver of bread of life. Where else can we go? So they stood with him, you know. They did not go anywhere. And they were enjoying the bread of life. So in the next, I will explain the rest.